Holy Gospel is written in the Gospel of St. Mark in the second chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and as they made their way, his disciples began to pluck heads of grain. The Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath?" And he said to them, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in the need of food? He entered the house of God when Abiathar was high priest and ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for any but the priest to eat, and he gave some to his companions. And then he said to them, 'The Sabbath was made for humankind and not humankind for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath.' Again he entered the synagogue, and a man was there who had a withered hand, and they watched him to see whether he would cure them on him on the Sabbath, so that they might accuse him. And he said to the man who had the withered hand, 'Come forward.' And he said to them, 'Is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath, to save life or to kill?' But they were silent. He looked around them with anger. He was grieved at their hardness of heart, and said to the man, 'Stretch out your hand.' He stretched it out, and his hand was restored. And the Pharisees went out and immediately conspired with the Herodians against him, how to destroy him." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Relationships are important. I've been thinking about that, particularly in the last couple days when Pastor Fred called me Friday and said, "Can you do a funeral tomorrow?" And I said, "Okay, tell me, what am I in for?" And I don't know the person. But I thought about relationships, and one of the things I noticed at Betty Haverschell's funeral was the relationships of family members. You see it all the time with those things. The children, the cousins, the nephews, the aunts, the grandchildren, the neighbors, the friends, they come together because a relationship is important to them. In this morning's gospel lesson, Jesus is talking about a relationship as well, a relationship not only to the Father who creates the Sabbath, but also to the people who live amongst those who celebrate the Sabbath. Jesus knows that there's the importance of the Sabbath. There are those stories in the Old Testament that attribute the establishment of the Sabbath to the creation story where God rested on that day, and there's another place in which it is reminded that after the Exodus, the Israelites were called to worship and to remember and honor the Sabbath. But relationships are important. But the important thing about that relationship, I think, is much more so the fact that the relationship is with God on that particular day. How do we honor the Sabbath but come together? We can come up with lots of rules, and that's what those folks around Jesus' time were looking at. We can come up with the rules. But Jesus is more importantly concerned about relationships. Well, as I looked at the narthex yesterday, I noticed the banner that you have out there, which is an important relationship for all of us. It says simply, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." And that comes from the 23rd Psalm, and I'd really like to talk a little bit more about that passage this morning as a way of also talking about our relationship with God. For it's one of the most favorite passages of Scripture, and it's even committed to memory for many, and possibly second only to John 3:16. And I suspect if we started this morning and you were willing to participate, I could just say, "Tell me the 23rd Psalm." We might have different translations, but we'd know how to start it out, and we know the passages, and I suspect that for many of us, it would sound very much like the King James Version. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." And you can finish that for yourself. Well, we teach it to the children we see aspects of it depicted in pictures of Jesus as a lamb, with a lamb perhaps around his shoulder. We even place it on a bumper sticker or refrigerator magnet, and I suspect you could probably find a tattoo artist who could put that on you as well. And often we hear the psalm in the midst of a memorial service or an ecumenical gathering, but it really reaches far beyond that in terms of our relationship with God and one another. You may recall some special circumstances for yourself where Psalm 23 was particularly important. I remember almost 40 years ago, as I was driving from my home in Colorado Springs, Colorado, to Fort Carson, Colorado, on Sunday mornings to listen to celebrate the worship with the Lutheran community on that base. There was a Presbyterian pastor in town who was preaching a series on the 23rd Psalm. And I was spellbound by the way he was presenting that and the care with which he did so. And years later, I can still think about that passage and about that time, and I even picked up the phone and called him, glad that he was alive, that we could talk about that series and that time. And I told him how special that was for me, driving down the road that in those mornings, and he shared with me a wonderful book, you may be familiar with it, by Philip Keller, A Shepherd Looks at Psalm 23. It's offering the insight of a shepherd into the activities of being a shepherd and how those passages of that psalm mean something special to him. And it gives you kind of the backstory for what goes on in the life of a shepherd. But that's a psalm that's brought comfort to the poor, courage to the disappointed, balm and consolation to the sick, lonely, and dying. And I'd like to just focus for a few minutes on that first verse, because I think it helps us remember why it's really a timely passage in Scripture and how it helps us learn about God and God's care for us, as Jesus demonstrates this morning. Well, one thing we might consider about the Bible is that the greatest statements of the Bible are often in the indicative mood rather than the imperative mood. They tell us who God is and what God does rather than what God commands. Psalm 23 has a focus on who and what about God. It holds up God, because God is the theme of that psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. He makes me lie down. He leads me on right paths. He restores my soul. He prepares a table. He anoints my head. All of these point to God, who God is, and what God does. And that's why Psalm 23 is so important. It tells us about God and his activities on our behalf. It's about the relationship God has with his people. Another aspect we could consider, I suppose, is the authorship. And there are those who would say it's David and others it's not David. But really, when it even talks about the house of the Lord, is it the Jerusalem temple which is not yet built, or is it referring to the household and fellowship of God's people? Regardless, the psalmist clearly has a shepherd's heart. And there are those who wonder, is it young David or old David that's writing this? If it's young, well, then he's declaring hope for the future, and he was seen early on as one with great promise. Remember how Samuel went to Bethlehem in the house of Jesse to select the next successor to King Saul. And David was out in the field taking care of the sheep. He knew what his role was in the family. He was tending that flock when Samuel found him and anointed him for a special future. Well, if it's old David writing this, well, then he's discovered much about God, and this would be a testimony of his personal faith, reflective of his life. In his youth, a person of great potential and promise, in his midlife, a fugitive in the wilderness, an adulterer and a murderer in Jerusalem. The one who was victorious over Goliath later experienced agony over the death of his own son, Absalom. The all-powerful king was later helpless at the grave of his infant child, Jedediah. The Lord is my shepherd, spoken by one who experienced many things in his life, and yet was able to cling to the faith, even the faith of a blatant sinner. The old David can certainly stand up and proclaim, the Lord is my shepherd. That's what my life has taught me. And I suspect that as we grow in faith and grow in years, we're able to say that as well, more vividly, and have more data to share with others for the as to how we know that the Lord has been with us. Now, the shepherd is clearly one who cares for his sheep, watches and protects them, guides them in life, takes care of their every need. And Jesus describes himself in John 10 as the good shepherd and tells us the importance of following the voice of the right shepherd. Now, God is like the shepherd addressing sorrows and needs. He stands with me on a sunny day. He looks through the dark nights with me when storms rage. From times of peril or in times of glory, God is there. And in the deep valleys of life, in the midst of despair, even death, he is with us. The Lord is like, well, we could say the Lord is my shepherd. The essence of religion is in the pronouns we use. It's not just that the Lord is your shepherd, but I can affirm the Lord is my shepherd. Each of us can do that. So who is the Lord? Well, the Hebrews had several words for God which were hardly uttered aloud. And yet David uses this one, Yahweh, and says in essence, God is awesome. Yahweh is my shepherd. Yahweh is the breath of life. Yahweh brought us through the Exodus into a new nation. And Yahweh reflects the majesty and the glory of the one we call God. This great, almighty God who created everything. The great and mighty God stands above and beyond us. He is like a shepherd with his sheep, caring for us and tending for us, even as a shepherd does. Now that's a revolutionary view of God, not a God who is far off and disconnected to us, but a God who has actually the word would share with us, the Hebrew word, the acquaintance, the companion, the friend, the shepherd. It's the same root word for all of those. So think of it. This mighty God is our friend. Maybe that's why he reaches out in the midst of the Sabbath and heals one who's in need of healing, because he is their friend and caring for them. He doesn't say, wait until tomorrow. He helps them now. In all of these, we discover God is our friend. David knew this, and we know it. In the high moments, in the low moments, in times of faithfulness, in times of faithlessness, we struggle, perhaps, to see him as a friend, because we say, well, if God is so great, how come this happens? If God is so great, how come? How come? Well, if we focus on the problem, we head for despair. If we focus on the solution, there is hope. Look around, take your eyes off of Jesus, and you won't be able to say so easily, the Lord is my friend. But look and see Jesus, see God, and what we see dispels all doubt about him. We know he is good, kind, and loving, our friend. And Jesus said, I and the Father are one. He who sees me sees the Father. So keep your eyes on Jesus. God is good. He is like Jesus. In John 10, he declares himself to be the Son of God, one with the Father, the Good Shepherd. And so we can say with David, the Lord is my shepherd. If Jesus is one with God, if Jesus is indeed the Son of God, if Jesus is the Good Shepherd, as the Scriptures declare, then all of us can affirm with absolute certainty and confidence, along with David, the Lord is my shepherd, the Lord Yahweh is my friend. And then we can gladly say, I shall not want. The Good News Bible says, I have everything I need. The Creator is our friend. What more is there? The sheep don't worry. They have absolute trust in the shepherd. The pasture was green yesterday. The pasture is green today. And they're confident it will be tomorrow. So trust God. He will lead, he will make, he will anoint, he will do all for us. In the midst of life, we will not be in want and despair. We are not, as Christians, immune or inoculated against troubles. They're part of life. David knew the truth of which he spoke. And Jesus told his disciples, in this world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. The living Bible reminds us, because he is my shepherd, I shall not want. If you set your sights on faith, there is no want. Good Shepherd will not forsake us, disappoint us, or lead us astray. If God is your shepherd, then that's your only want. And Jesus said, I'm the shepherd, I'm the gate. And the shepherd provides for us the Holy Church, the apostolic ministry, and the blessed sacraments. And so maybe that commandment this morning that tells us to honor the Sabbath day, to sanctify the holy day, depending on what translation we're using, maybe that's just the way we do it. We honor the holy day by remembering our relationship with God and giving respect to that relationship. And Jesus honored that holy day by helping one in need. We can certainly do that as well. But we also know that we can worship, we can share the faith, we can give thanks to God who reaches out to us as our shepherd. We are in a new gated community. The gate and the shepherd are one. The risen Christ is the one who nourishes his people with word and sacraments, giving them life and enabling them to have it abundantly. I think little Jimmy had it right when he recited the song one day in Sunday school. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. And that's all that counts. Think of relationships, if you will. Relationships with your family, your friends, with one another in this place. And remember to sanctify the holy day in your relationships with God through Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior. And maybe, just maybe, when we do that more effectively, every day will be for us a holy day, a Sabbath.